Hello, world. What is up? Welcome to Build. I'm your host, Matt Forte. We are here live at the Build Studio in New York City. Oh, man. Our next guest is the brilliant mind behind the 2002 phenomenon that is My Big Fat Greek Wedding. In the nearly 20 years since the film's debut, she's starred in a ton of shows and movies. She's voiced a bunch of cartoons. She wrote a book. And now, on February 1st, on Lifetime, you can catch her in the ripped from the headlines film Poisoned Love. Oh, my goodness. Please make a crazy amount of noise and welcome the wonderful Nia Vardalos right here. Come on. Let's go.
Hi. People at home, I hope you're clapping. Hello.
They do. They clap at home.
Yay. I clap too. I used to do workout videos and clap at the end of it.
No way. Yeah. Well, that's a little celebration for yourself.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah, you've got to.
Oh, wait, I forgot. When they go, good job, I go, yay.
Thank you. Yeah. I don't know what that is. As humans,
yeah.
People applaud. You want to join in?
I think so.
I think there's something about it.
Embrace the happiness.
I want to be a part of it. Look how excited they are. I want to be excited. They seem well. Did you hear the applause?
Yeah, that was really nice. I feel like my mom paid you all to be here. That was very nice. Thanks for coming.
I did notice your last name is on all of my checks, so I think your mom has a hand in this.
Yeah, it's in Canadian funds because I'm from Winnipeg.
Exactly. Congratulations. I'm super excited to talk to you about this project.
About my murder movie?
Yes, your murder film. Your ripped from the headlines murder movie. We're going to have a lot of fun talking about that. First and foremost, so how are you? How's Nia?
I am good. Yeah. I'm fine. I'm in New York. It's always good to be here. I was here doing a play in 2017 and then 2016, and it was really nice to live in New York for the first time. And then I went back and did other things, and then I wanted to see what it was like to do a murder movie. That's what I keep calling it. This murder movie, just to there's do a drama.
Oh yeah, and call me crazy, maybe I'm wrong here, but was that play that you just mentioned, was it kind of like part of the journey to getting here? Is that the one that you wrote and starred in?
Yes.
Yes, okay.
That is exactly right.
There we go.
My dilemma is that there is a dearth of material for women. So rather than whine about it and not, you know, or cry that I'm not gonna get any parts offered to me, I just write my way out of these little holes. So I wanted to do a drama. Cheryl Strayed was kind enough to let me option her book. Tommy Kail directed our play and gave me the book. And I adapted it and got to star in a drama for 2 years doing this play. Then it got licensed and published by Samuel French, now Concord. And it went, now it's in 20 theaters all over the US. But the point was to do something that was different outside my comfort zone. But what happened is, by doing that play, the producers from Lifetime saw me in a drama and then offered me a drama.
They were like, ooh, she can do drama very well.
Yeah.
Now, was that something that because of, and I'm sorry, I promise I won't bring up Greek Wedding a lot. But
that's
okay. Well, I just feel
grateful for it.
I assume that was the case because you're a lovely person. I just wonder though, like it's one of those things where you hope and dream that you're going to write and star in a thing that people will love. But then I don't know what it's like that for the next 20 years of your life, idiots like me constantly ask you about it. And it's like you do all these things for 20 years, you've heard about this thing. So I never know, like, what is that like to experience that?
It would be like someone talking about high school, you know, something that you went through together. And we went through My Big Fat Greek Wedding together. Because even though I wrote it about my family, it was about yours too. Yeah. So I feel like I'm just grateful for it. I never have that feeling of, ugh, you know, to do two or three, or do we get to six? You know, do I keep telling the story about this family? No, I'm never going to eye roll it. It's something incredible that happened to me.
Were you ever surprised that, and I've talked about another artist last week, that the more specific you get in your writing, it seems the larger, more mass appeal it has.
That was not something I knew before. I wrote that script, and it's something I learned after. Because I thought I wrote a movie about my crazy family, and I found out your family's crazy. Yeah.
All of our families are crazy.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Okay, but anyway, so you do that, right? Blows up. It becomes, like I said, a phenomenon. It's everywhere. And now you want to do serious things, but everybody wants you to do the Greek thing
again. I get offered My Big Fat Turkish Wedding, My Big Fat French Wedding. And I'm not going to complain because to be paid to write and act.
Great problem to have.
That's all I wanted.
Exactly.
Yeah. So, and 100%. My friends are all really obscenely optimistic. Yeah. We all create our own material. We all try to get out there and do stuff. So the fact that I get to do stuff is just, it's like gravy.
Yeah.
So yes, I do every day. My agents will call and say, what about My Big Fat Greek Cookbook? What about My Big Fat Greek Musical? Just anything. And I get it. And the producers of Big Fat Greek Wedding did offer me number three while I was doing number two. And I wanted to do my play first and some murder movies and just some other things because I think doing other things informs my writing. Yeah. I can't write three until I live a little bit of life.
Well, that was kind of the brilliance of two when it came along. It's like, yes, a lot of time had passed, but there was so much for you to fold into that now.
Yeah.
So it's like to rush and get to three, it's like, well, it wouldn't be the same story if we didn't give you time.
Yeah, I got to live. I got to do some stuff.
You got to do some stuff. And here is some stuff that you have done. So let's talk about this. So you do the play. They say, hey, we got a murder movie and we want you to do it. And you were like, I'm there right away. Is that how it worked? Or?
No, I think my agent said something like this. Hi, you say no to everything. And I was like, good to see you. And then he said,
let's start the conversation.
Yeah. Then he said, Catherine Zeta-Jones did a Lifetime movie. And I said, is she in this movie? And he said, no, stay with me. And yeah. And then he said, it's about a woman who lost two husbands, and then her daughter commits suicide, and the police are looking at her for the murder, obviously, they think she's guilty. And I read the script, and I couldn't figure out for the first 55 pages who did it. Right. And that intrigued me. And then the director said, I want you to all play it as if you're innocent. And then he said to me, you know that likable thing you do? Like as if he smelled something. He was like, do that.
Do the likable thing.
I was like, oh, God.
Well, you know what's funny is in watching this, and one of the things that I was going to say before you ever brought that story up was that the reason it's fun to watch you in this serious thing is because even though I know the story this is based on, and I'm like a true crime nut, and I know exactly what's happening, it's there's something, that likable thing that you do, I watch it, and I go, oh, wait, maybe I don't know exactly what happened here. And it's just like, it's a totally different way to watch it, having, you know, Nia Vardalos there in the front. It's like, I really like this person. and then you learn about what this person's done.
Yeah.
It was just a very interesting choice.
I think I've learned something in focus groups with films. Audiences are quite hard on women. And we want, in the focus groups, we will see that they want the woman to be likable. Like, in a film's focus group, if the man sleeps around a minute after his wife dies and then finds somebody, the audience will forgive that. But they do not forgive that with a woman. They want their women to be likable. However, Lifetime is doing these movies where we don't necessarily have to be likable. So even though the director said that as a joke, because believe me, in the morning, first thing, I'm not likable. Nobody is. he let me go to this place of really not being a very endearing person. And I wanted to do that.
It starts endearing. And as the movie goes, like almost second by second, each little bit chips away and you start to see, which was, to me, it must have been really fascinating to dive into that and play that.
It was so freeing. And to look through a script and not search for the laughs like I always do, like, oh, I could play that there. Oh, I could fall there. Oh, well, I'll spill this on myself there. All the tricks that we try and find to look for comedy. I mine comedy, hopefully, in a script. I didn't have to do this at all.
Was any of that scary?
Yes.
Oh, wow. Tell
it was
me.
Unsettling. Yes.
Yeah, I can imagine.
I didn't feel comfortable and like I knew what I was doing. And that's usually when you know you're doing the right thing in a job.
Right.
If you get the opportunity to take something that's not necessarily what you do for a living and you don't feel good, you're supposed to be there.
Right.
I think. I mean, on a date, if you don't feel good, get out.
Get out. Right. Yeah, okay,
yeah,
that's fair.
That's not the same.
That's sound advice.
Yes.
That is a good idea.
But in a job, if you're pushing yourself, because I have a daughter, and I'm always telling her, try new things and do new things, and I have nieces and nephews, and always, you know, the big fat Greek family sits around and gives unsolicited advice. It's what we do.
Yeah.
Unsolicited advice, and we discuss bodily hair removal. That's our thing.
That's
all we do. Yeah.
All the time.
These are the two things. And I realized that our unsolicited advice is constantly try new things. So I took my own advice, and I tried something new.
Was it challenging? Because I hear this all the time as well. Whenever an actor comes through, they have to play a bad person or a bad character or an evil person. That character doesn't know that they're the bad character or that they're evil, right? So you've got to find that as a performer and find that side. As such an awesome mom, was it hard to play this less than awesome mom?
I don't know if I'm an awesome mom. I think anybody who thinks they're good at it truly sucks.
Got it.
It's like writers. If you're like, I'm amazing as you're writing something, it's terrible. So, but as a mom, it is horrible to explore the feelings of not being a good mother. I was really quite upset during the filming of this movie. I had to film scenes of domestic violence, really outside my comfort zone. But I loved how I felt after that scene and after there are certain scenes. I know it's in the trailer, so I'm not giving anything away, but at one point my character is handcuffed and I had bruises up and down my arms, even though we were very careful with each other and we studied stage combat, but it happens from repetitive handcuff use. Don't pretend you don't know.
And the whole room is very familiar with what you're talking about. I got some new crowd.
And it felt really interesting to be doing something that's not my thing.
What, as I mentioned earlier, I'm a self-proclaimed true crime nut. How familiar were you with the Stacey Castor story and what this is sort of based on and the headline that it's ripped from? Did you have any knowledge of that prior? Did you do research going into this?
I had no idea before I read the script. So as I kept reading, I was like, wait, did the mom do it? Did the daughter do it? Did Stacey do it? It was really well written. Yeah. And the director told us all to play it as if we were innocent because, you know, good liars lie well. Very well. So I like that part of it, but then going into it, about to begin filming, I did a ton of research and realized that there were certain things about this woman's life that, although we didn't get a chance to show them in the film, I mean, her own father died under possibly mysterious circumstances. And wow. Yeah, it's definitely, for me, it's about mental health.
Do you ever, I mean, how different is that process here when you're dealing with a character based on a real person versus a character that's fictionalized, that you've made up? Is there more pressure? Is there a responsibility? Even someone like Stacey here, who allegedly did terrible things, you know, what does that do to the process? How does that feel for you as an actor? I have a responsibility to this story versus you wrote it. You made it up. It's a fictional character. It's freeing in a way.
Yeah, I think if you're telling someone's real story, you have an absolute responsibility to tell only the facts and to not make something up. I know that has happened recently in some movie making, that people have taken artistic license with someone's true life. And if you depict them in a way that is unethical, that is unethical, I believe. But in telling the story about this woman, I was provided facts about her online. Yeah. In the, everything's online, the court documents, the actual transcripts of the trial you can read. And one of the things that they do in the movie is they have an actual letter that is real from Stacey Castor's life that's read in a scene.
I believe her daughter reads it.
Yeah, it was hard. That was hard.
That must have been
brutal. We were all just hanging on like, oh, I'm going to cry.
Yeah.
It was hard.
Like a really hard day.
Yes.
What's funny is like there were unquestionably hard days. You talk about, you had to do a scene involving domestic violence. But looking at your Instagram, some wonderful photos of you and the kids and the crew and everybody having between takes. It seemed like you were finding moments to have fun and keep each other happy.
Yes.
Is that important on a project like this?
Yes.
Being your first murder film.
That's my rule. Yeah. That is my rule. When you are number one on the call sheet, I feel that you are hosting a party. The call sheet is, as you know, it's the actor's name and the time that they're called in, that they're going to go to hair and makeup. And number one means that usually that you're the lead of the film. Of course, someone could be number two and they can be your co-lead. But number one, you are saying, come to my home. Let me make sure you have food and something to drink. Be comfortable on that couch. Okay, let's act. That's how I feel. I think I'm hosting a party. And so it has to come from me to be kind, to be compassionate, to know this person's going through a bad day and maybe they don't want to mic me the way that I was mic'd yesterday. Right. We're all coming together like circus folk. We're making this movie. We might not see each other again. So it's got to be fun. That's my number one rule.
That's something we hear a lot here as well, that number one sets the tone. When did you learn that? Did you learn that in a Greek wedding? Did you know that going in? Like, if I'm number one, I know this is how I have to do this.
I got the opportunity to guest star on a couple of things, and I saw Jennifer Grey be number one on something that I was the guest star on, and she was amazing. She came over to me, said, welcome. This is where we put our coats and purses for the table read. That was good. Good peoples. Yeah, so I saw that, and I saw the opposite on people that I will not name. the opposite. And I just thought if I ever get the chance to be a working actor that I would do it.
I'm going to be that one. I'm going to be the coats and purses person.
Yes.
I'm going to let everybody know. Yeah.
Yep.
Of course. Well, it just seems like that's naturally kind of part of your personality. Like, you would gravitate to that side.
I hope so.
Yeah.
I hope so. It's terrible that sometimes people who are not kind are rewarded in my mm-hmm. industry and in politics. What?
I know what you're talking about.
Yeah. And I just think it takes so little. It takes so little. And it's actually, I wouldn't even call it kindness. I call it decency. Just be decent.
Yeah. Just be a decent human being.
Just say good morning.
We're gonna go in a second over to some audience questions. I always like to leave time, make sure we get a bunch of audience questions. But I saw this again through your social media that your book sold out. It was selling out on Amazon again. It came out a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
But it's still, you just can't keep it in stock. You can't keep it going. Similar to how we talked about, you need time between films. I know you just wrote this book, but are you thinking about another book, perhaps?
You know, I do. I have a 2-book deal, and again, they told me to just take my time and decide what I want to write. Maybe there's a lot of autonomy in the book world, which I really liked. The reason that my book sells out is because it is not just about adoption. It's a memoir, but it is also handed from person to person, like Cheryl Strayed's Tiny Beautiful Things. People recommend it to somebody. It's like a salve if you are going through perhaps a struggle to become a parent. There's a How to Adopt index in the back of the book. And I donate all the proceeds to get kids adopted. And that's my side job. That's what I say.
Really?
That's what I say. It's my side job because I think it's the reason that my big fat Greek wedding happened to me. I think I was supposed to become a known person so that I could go through the struggle to become a parent, to meet my daughter through American foster care when she was almost 3 years old, to write this book to get kids adopted. That's what I think.
Yeah.
The side part is I got to kiss John Corbett. Fun.
Nobody's complaining about that.
Yeah, no.
That's fine. Well, that's a pretty amazing side job that you have, and you do a lot of amazing work. Thank you for all that you do. And congratulations on this. Again, February 1st, 8 o'clock, 7 Central on Lifetime. Your murder movie is happening, Poison Love. There it is. Do you have other murder movies in the pipeline?
You know, when I was doing Tiny Beautiful Things, yeah. I did 8 shows a week, which is, you know, the standard New York theater contract, so I had to be quiet, which is hard for me. As you see, I like to talk. So I decided to be quiet for the 8 show week. I would write a movie during the second run of the play, and I wrote a drama, and we're going to go into production on it very soon. And it's not a murdering movie, but it's a quirky drama.
That's exciting. All right, well, you got to come back for that. I'm made of questions now. Obviously, you can't reveal anything, but that's very cool here. Congratulations on that.
Thanks.
Kate, we've got a bunch of questions. Let's go. It's at least 2 of them I want to get. So let's go. We got microphones in the room.
Hi.
Hello, right in the front. Go for it.
What is in your personal professional bucket list?
That is amazing. What is my personal professional bucket list? I want to do a musical on stage on Broadway. I would like to do a musical film. And I would like to animate a character in a movie. Those are my 3 professional bucket list things.
You've done some, great question. You've done voiceover and animation before.
Yes, not a movie though.
Not a movie.
Yeah.
Do you want to write the animated movie as well?
I would be open to it, but I also would be open to voicing something that is, again, outside my comfort zone. I once took a voiceover class, and the person made us animate sand. Like, just what would sand sound like? And that really stayed with me, that it would be interesting to animate something that I didn't think of.
Right. Very
Did you, when you said you want to do a musical, does that mean you want to write a musical?
Maybe, or revive one. I actually am. I'm classically trained in Shakespeare and musical theater.
I did a ton of research. I somehow didn't stumble upon that.
Yeah, that's what I did. That's how I made my living until I got into Second City, and then I went on a different path and started to write material.
That's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
So your family must have really been relieved when Big Fat Greek Wedding took off. And they were like,
yeah.
Here we go, okay.
They were like, oh, God. They all came to me and went, you owe us some money.
You are classically trained.
That's amazing. Thank you for that question. Can I do one more, please? Yes, let's get one more question. You've got a microphone.
Hi.
My question is, what was it like getting into the psyche of a Black Widow, like someone that has murdered before? Like, what was it like? What was your process as an actor to get into that?
I actually had very good advice from the director and the producer, Jim Donovan and Danielle von Zelnick, that this is a regular person that something irregular happened to. And I know this sounds ridiculous, but that's my life. I'm just an ordinary person that something extraordinary happened to and that my first movie took off. So I realize everyone has weird things happen to them. You could be walking down the street and, you know, something could fall on your head and it's change your life just like that. Stacey Castor, I believe, was the victim of domestic violence and her life took a left turn. So I tried to play it as somebody who I think what we all have inside us is the instinct to survive. At what cost? I'm not sure how far we'll all go. That's a question actually that I ask myself a lot. what would I do if I did something wrong? How far would I go to cover it? That's why I was up a lot during this film. I didn't sleep very well because it's really a disquieting feeling to think, could I cover up some really bad things? Yeah. Could you? You could, for sure. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, for sure.
We say that to everybody on that couch. Not just you.
That's the murdering couch.
That's the murdering couch.
Yeah,
precisely.
That's what we call it.
That's exactly. Well, as much as I'd like to go through what all the couches are called,
yeah.
We only have time for that one. Thank you guys so much for your questions and being here and hanging out and being
Thanks,
an awesome
everybody.
Audience. Thanks to those that tuned in and watched from home. I want to remind everybody that Poisoned Love, the Stacey Castor story, it's going to be on Lifetime February 1st, 8, 7 Central. Do not miss Nia's first big murder movie. You're wonderful in it. It's a fantastic performance, and it's a really great project. I'm excited to see what's next and all the wonderful things you're working on.
Thanks.
And have you back. Thank you again, everybody. Please, crazy amount of noise.
Thank you.
It's not enough. More for Nia Vardalos right here.